Hachette Audio presents Hyperefficient. Optimize your brain to transform the way you work. Written and read by Mithu Storoni.
Section A. A new kind of efficiency. What may emerge as the most important insight of the 21st century is that man was not designed to live at the speed of light. Marshall McLuhan. Once upon a time, news travelled no faster than the pace of scurrying feet. Technology upended that world. It distorted time, contorted space, and gradually synchronized minds and brains across the globe into a fluid new reality. On the 27th of August, 1883, the residents of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, shuddered in terror when the mighty volcano Krakatoa in Java, Indonesia, emitted the loudest sound ever to be heard on Earth. The deafening blast was actually imperceptible to the people of Milwaukee, and yet they trembled as if Krakatoa had erupted right in their backyards. A new communication technology called the telegraph was responsible for this peculiar dismembering of reality. It disseminated news of the disaster to 60 newspapers across the world, thereby shattering the immutability of space and time as the scaffold of existence. Human beings could now hop into a reality thousands of miles away without needing hours or even weeks to arrive. Or, as the philosopher Marshall McLuhan put it, today it's only too easy to have dinner in New York and indigestion in Paris. Before the railroads arrived, Americans lived on sun time. Each town in the United States had its very own brand of time, set by the position of the sun in the sky, and every degree change of longitude resulted in a time difference of 4 minutes. After the railroads arrived, Americans could no longer let the sun decide what time it was, as this created too much confusion. On April 19th, 1883, the New York Times lamented how 56 standards of time are now employed by the various railroads of the country in preparing their schedules of running times. Human pace had now overtaken the sun's, and the sun would have to concede the reins of time to humans. By the end of 1883, the hills and valleys of time had flattened into a continuous American landscape, and standard time was born. Once technology began to contort the coordinates of time and space, it played puppeteer to the trajectory of human existence. Railroad tracks defined where humans moved, and railroad timetables decided when. Humans consented to confine their movements, and in turn the patterns of their lives, to the departure and arrival times printed on a train schedule in exchange for a more efficient way of life. Soon, the quest for efficiency would change the way humans moved within even tighter confines of time and space. Over the course of the 19th century, scientists from Helmholtz to Huxley had shown that humans, like inefficient machines, waste energy. As the century neared its end, a sedulous Pennsylvania machine shop engineer named Frederick Winslow Taylor noticed that a worker's output could be substantially augmented if they did not stray beyond a strict choreographed sequence of movements while they worked. Taylor realized that the limiting factor in manual work was not insufficient physical effort, but wasted physical effort. A precisely designed routine could accelerate an entire manufacturing process and even make the work easier. Taylor was the first to study the science of work efficiency in an industrial workplace rather than in a laboratory, and this made his findings immediately translatable to the real world. As his ideas spread across manufacturing plants in the United States, One plant, the Ford Motor Company, took the mission of improving efficiency to an entirely new level. Engineers at the plant experimented with a strategy that would turn the standard model of car manufacturing upside down. Instead of several engineers working on one car at a time, as they had always done, one engineer worked on several cars in quick succession by moving each on a conveyor belt in the form of an assembly line. This erased the time wasted between jobs and significantly escalated output per unit time. Their strategy proved so successful that the Ford Motor Company went from producing 11 cars in a month to churning one out every 24 seconds, and the assembly line took the stage as the global model for efficiency. Little by little, all flavors of work were recast into an assembly line template. The undulations of farm labor flattened into a continuous moving belt of mechanized agriculture. Identical houses were assembled from a moving belt of parts, and even patients on hospital clinic conveyor belts waited their turn to be fixed. In the 1950s, when a large portion of work moved from the hands to the head, many rural Americans flocked to urban America, seduced by the shiny, gilded image of white-collar knowledge workers working comfortably for better pay. But the factory model of work had hardly changed. Office workers sat in place and performed monotonous, almost automatic work on repeat. They clocked in every morning and out in the evening, fueled by caffeine and interrupted only by hunger's call to lunch. Even the office layouts were modeled after the factory floor, with desks crammed in rows like stations on an assembly line. By 1970, the most dissatisfied workers in the country were no longer blue-collar workers assembling parts in a factory, but white-collar clerical workers on desk jobs. Industrial-age factories had metamorphosed into gleaming, shiny offices, and desk workers' brains were the new assembly lines. As a 1972 report by a special task force to the United States Secretary of Health, Education and Welfare described it, the office today, where work is segmented and authoritarian, is often a factory. Computer key punch operations and typing pools share much in common with the automobile assembly line. A linear, continuous assembly line configuration of work emphasizes quantity over quality. When you flatten the natural fluctuation of your mental engine into a straight line, you prevent the lows, but you also prevent the highs. There is no room for flair or brilliance or for out-of-the-box thinking. For well over a century, the majority of white-collar work did not demand complex thinking or exceptional creativity, so this was of no great significance. Human minds were mere cogs in the production machine. How much they worked mattered more than how well they worked. In an assembly line of moving minds, as in an assembly line of moving hands, quantity decided the bottom line. It's a feature of the human condition that whenever we encounter a limit, we problem-solve our way around it by creating tools. When the pace of human hands hit a ceiling of maximum output, we supplanted human hands with automated machine parts. When the computational power of the human mind limited progress, we delegated its labor to calculators, then to computers, and then to supercomputers. Machine intelligence can now do straightforward knowledge work more efficiently than humans. Automated trading has replaced human minds across Wall Street trading floors. Legal firms are integrating chatbots into their legal service. And AI races ahead of eye surgeons to successfully screen patients for diabetic eye disease. With AI gaining territory over lower-level thinking jobs, the knowledge work spectrum is shifting towards an emphasis on idea generation, complex learning, and problem-solving. In his book, Exponential, Azim Azhar describes how a company's worth today depends more on its intangible assets than on its tangible ones. The algorithms in a search engine's platform are more valuable than the physical factories that manufacture its hardware. And the brand identity of a company like Apple holds more value than the physical cost of all its products. These intangible assets are realized through an exceptional level of brain work. Products have also grown so complex in the digital.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.